Thank you very much. I'm really honored to be here, and you know, it is really an international gathering, and the fact that I was thinking that the fact that there is a globalization going on is demonstrated by two things that happened today. The first one is that I found myself drinking a cappuccino after lunch, which is a typical German attitude when in Italy. And the second one is that we are half an hour late, which is a typical Italian attitude. So we are reversing the two things. So thanks. Yeah. Well, I just after saying this, I mean, it is really an honor to be here and with this event organized for GERT and you know, everything has been said about what GERT has done in terms of robotics and how advanced has been you know, his mind. He was always in front of. But I want to stress one thing that it always you know, surprised me and you know, struck me about GERT. And I am an academic, and most of you, or some of you, are academics. So you know that you know, in academics there are what I call the real lions and just cats, you know, without any, and you know, the just cats, you know, are people that present academic, some academics present simple achievements, you know, as if they were exceptional, you know. They see themselves on the mirror as if they were lions, and in fact they are, you know, maybe good cats, but cats. And then there are others which present exceptional achievements, as if they were simple, you know, and GERT is one of them. GERT is a real lion, you know. Every time I've heard him, you know, in the last 20 years, his speeches, you know, I had the impression that it was simple to do it, and then it was not. So, in some sense, you know, for us, it has been a sort of a, you know, goal. You know, it sounded easy, so why not doing it? And then we discovered that it was difficult. So thanks, GERT, for your, you know, I would say modesty. I mean, you, when you present things, you really, we really see that you don't need to emphasize what you are doing. In fact, that's my contribution to, this is one of the quality that I think GERT has and not many others have. Okay, so now getting to the idea of what I'm going to talk. I mean, what I'm going to talk about science and engineering, you know, and starting from our the goal of our research, which is to understand aspects of human intelligence by building artificial systems. And this is a strong statement, but it is basically what motivates us. It's not the only outcome we have, but is the main motivation. So try to bridge knowledge and knowing and building, to bridge science and engineering. And you know, translated in terms of robotics, this long-term goal means that we are trying to build systems that interact with humans as if they were humans, you know, and I stress this as if, you know, systems that can be companions, helpers, apprentices, and systems that can learn from humans in the way we learn from other humans. So it is a, you know, what do I mean? We can reinvent somehow the Turing test, you know, and say that we are interested in building robots, which, you know, in some sense, which you don't know, you know, if there is a human inside. You know, it's basically something like that. So, in this, along this this path, what we do, you know, we see humanoids as the equivalent of a wind tunnel, where you study aerodynamics. You know, a humanoid is a tool which allows us to study and test human interaction, human-machine interaction. So in this sense, it is not only a goal. Of course, we are interested in building humanoids for future applications. But for us, it is more important the role of humanoids as means, a way of investigating human-machine interaction. You know, you can transfer what you obtain, what you study, to a lot of different embodiments. You're not necessarily stuck with a human-like body, But you need to have a reference frame where to confront what you develop with humans, with human interaction. And you know, and this kind of long-term goal that we have, we also share with other scientists. And particularly, we have been sharing this with neuroscientists, because what we are interested in building in robots, neuroscientists are interested in understanding how they are implemented in humans. And this, I will stress this a little bit. So, in fact, we are addressing, in some sense, in the department at IIT, we are addressing a dual challenge, in fact, because we are studying humans, in particular how humans develop during the first years of life. We are also building humanoids, and the ICAB is one of the few humanoids, full humanoids in the world, which is built in Italy. But what we are interested in is in explore the interaction. In fact, in my opinion, I mean, the real motivation to work with the humanoids is to study interaction. Otherwise, well, there are other interesting applications for humanoids, but with a human-like body, you can really stress natural interaction. So, how far are we from machines interacting with us as if they were humans? And which way are we proposing to go? Okay, this is mostly the main theme of what I'm going to talk about. Where we are now, you can see it. I mean, I have this video clip. Some of you have seen it because I've shown, just to show, you know, how machines or humans interact with machines these days. It has happened to many of us, I'm sure. You know, this guy is going there. You know, it has printed something, and the printer, for some reason, you know, doesn't work. You know, the sheet of paper is white. You know, so he goes back very patiently, you know, on the keyboards. He probably prints again, send again the same commands, you know, and then it goes there and wait patiently. So it's a patient guy, you know, it's there. It's just a big size, but not. So he prints, well, the same thing, you know. So he opens up. He doesn't know anything about the printer, maybe, but it takes, you know, the toner out and then put it back. You know, it's something that we do, and then the machine does something wrong, you know. There is this speed. And now, you know, you see what the real human-machine interaction level is today, you know. It goes there, and, you know, so this is basically, this is basically the status of the art, the status of the art today of, you know, of man-machine interaction. Of course, I mean, this is clearly not working. I mean, it's like shooting to ourselves. It doesn't work, you know. This way, it doesn't work. What we are trying to do, what we need to do, you know, we want to move away from the remote control approach, you know, pushing buttons, interpreting symbolics, you know, symbolic representation of actions, you know, the big arrow, you know, you have to do all this, you have to adapt your mind to the machine. It's not the reverse, you know. And, you know, and even if we grow extra thumbs, you know, in 15,000 years, we may grow six fingers just to help ourselves to handle the remote control. But this does not work. This does not work because these machines are basically, you know, reaching, we are reaching the limit of our cognitive abilities. You know, I have a cell phone in my pocket. I'm using it, you know, probably 10% of what I could do with this. Because, I mean, I consider myself not a stupid person. I mean, maybe a small cat, as you were saying before. But and in spite of that, I'm not using all this technology. It is there, but it is not available. It's not there, you know. And we need to go somehow, you know, from the idea of the human in the loop to the idea of the human in the center. You know, we need to study interaction, which must become intuitive. You know, less scary, you know, no need to learn how to use something. Basically, machines with no manuals. You know, that's the goal. So machine with no manuals, you know. But, you know, so I was talking about humanoids. I was telling you we are studying humanoids and humans. and you know, exploiting the interaction between the two. So the next question is, you know, how come we do not need manuals when we interact with each other? What is the reason why? You know, and it's a very well, it may be a very stupid question, but if you ask it, it's not so superficial. You know, it's not so superficial. Basically, we don't need manuals when we interact with each other because the way we interact is more a two-way process. It's something like which I call mutual interaction. Mutual understanding. We understand what each other is doing, you know, and we understand what each other is doing because we had in the past, you know, we had the same experience, we had the same goals, you know, and we built up this past experience through, you know, interactions, but through exchange of information, you know, through speech, through gesture, to touching each other, so it's a physical way of conveying information. And at the end, we understand each other. You know, we don't need to explain everything. You know, we can assume. You know, we can imagine what the other people in front of us is willing to do, is interested in doing. And this mutual understanding is rooted in the morphology of the body that we have. And this is the reason, main reason why we need humanoids, because our history is developed, our experience develops with our own body. And we can certainly say that, you know, if we have a similar morphology, then we act in a similar way and we acquire a similar experience. So it is not, it is the way we behave that matters most. You know, when we want to design systems that interact with us as if, you know, is the way we move, the gesture. You know, in Italy we exaggerate with the gestures maybe, but that's a way of conveying information and putting it forward. So, in fact, this idea of mutual understanding somehow, you know, in the past there was this idea that the brain was a computer. Now we know that the brain is not a computer, it's something different, you know. But this idea of mutual understanding, you know, can tell us that the brain is somehow a wizard because it can predict the future. You know, it can tell you what is going to happen in the future. And I have this short video clip again, which I show very often, of this Irish boy going toward the whiskey bottle. And, you know, and you knew before that the bottle was going to fall. You knew it before because you had the same goal to reach for a whiskey bottle in your history, or for another bottle, so for what matters. But so you have the same goal, you have the same body, but you have more experience. You experienced you know, handling bottles, and you knew that the bottle was falling down. So in some sense, you are predicting. What was going to happen. So this idea of mutual understanding, in fact, is something that we can be condensed by saying that it is the ability of putting ourselves in someone else's shoes, which is difficult, which is something that children develop 6-7 years, you know, so it takes a lot of time to do that, to be able to put yourself in someone else's shoes, you know, because then you can, you know, anticipate the intentions of others. And this is the real way of interaction. And you can, you know, imagine what they are feeling, you know, what is their internal desire, you know, because if you put yourself, you basically assume that you are the others and vice versa, you know. So where are these magic skill coming from? Well, these sort of magic skills of predicting, being able to predict what is going to happen, are coming from our ability to learn new goal-directed actions. We are able to learn and to consolidate these actions, you know, this motor repertoire into somewhere in our brain. I will explain it a little bit afterwards. I mean, the example is very simple. You know, when you first learn a new action, you somehow have to reason about how to perform the action. You are using, you know, again, stressing it too much maybe, but you are using your mind. You know, you reason and you control your body in a very precise way, and you use all possible sources of information, including help from someone else, like your mother. After you learn the action, this is consolidated somehow. It is as if it was transferred to your body. It is there, you never forget it. It is. It allows you to predict what is going to happen, but not only the motor actions. And this is something which I want to stress. In your memory, in your experience, you have the motor actions, you have the feeling of the wind in your face, the feeling of the, you know, of what you feel in the butt. It is really a very rich. It is really a very rich sensory motor memory that you develop and you store there. You store it somewhere. You don't know where, you know, or maybe we know there. You know where, and we know a little bit about that because neuroscientists, in fact, have discovered that the basis of our prediction ability, where this sensory motor representation is or seems to be stored, is in a system that they call mirror neuron systems, that I'm sure some of you at least have heard about. But I'm going to spend a couple of words there because it gives the discovery of mirror neurons, I think it gives roboticians like us in this room a much more central role in understanding what human intelligence is. Because it takes the body of the person, its motor abilities, and put it there in an area which, you know, at the beginning of AI, it was considered just a mind thing, something that you can study or you can investigate or implement using computers and without any. And why? I mean, for example, these researchers have discovered what they call canonical neurons, you know, and very short, you know, these are neurons, single neurons, that is a single elementary processing in our brain, which are activated specifically every time the monkey, in this particular case, sees an object which she can pick up with two fingers. And another neuron is firing if the monkey sees an object that she can pick up with a full hand. So it is a visual feature which is coded in motor terms. There is no more vision system or motor system. It is represented in terms of motor commands. So it is not the shape of the object that matters, but how you grasp it. No? And that is the reason why roboticians are in the center of understanding how intelligence works. And these mirror neurons are even more surprising because there are, again, single neurons, single elementary components, which fire, for example, if the monkey is picking up an object with two fingers, but also, you know, they are activated if the monkey sees someone else picking up an object with two fingers. So it is specific for the goal, it is specific for the grasp type. So it is not only representing what it means in somehow, you know, in some sense, again, I'm stressing it too much, but it is the imagination neuron, you know. This neuron is able to imagine what the person in front is doing, is interpreting. I'm stressing it very much, and you know, these days mirror neurons have been used to explain all possible behavior of humans. I think they are, you know, you have to, of course, to restrict this to specific things, but the important thing is that it has to be a goal-directed action, and it is stimulated by vision. This is the real scientific important results here. And which impact does it have on interaction? You know, why robotics is in the center? Well, because the discovery of mirror neurons is demonstrated that in order to understand an action performed by someone else, or to anticipate the goal of the action, we are using the part of the brain which is involved in the execution of that action. So there is no more a bodiless interpreter. It has to have a body. or at least a knowledge about body movement. You know? And I have a very simple, just presenting just one result of an experiment that was done by a group in Rome, just to show that the better I am in acting, the better I am in understanding. And what these people did was to show video clips, like the one that I'm going to show here. You know, a person shooting a ball into the basket. And the question was, is the ball going into the basket or not? Okay, so ballistic, simple ballistic movements, you know, in some sense. But they made it difficult, you know. Instead of just showing the whole movement or a big part of the movement, they started by showing just half a second of the movement, you know, of the shooting. And what they discovered is that for professional basketball players, they are very good. They can tell you above chance if the ball is going inside or not. You know, if you are a fan of basket, you need to see a little bit more in order to be able to say that the ball is going on, and so on and so forth. So if you are not interested in basketball at all, then you have to see everything. What I'm stressing here are two things. You know, the first thing you know, is that for the professional basketball player, it's not the trajectory of the ball that counts. The ball has not even left the hand, it's still there in the hand of the they are interpreting the action itself, the posture, you know, the dynamics of the initiation of the movement, and so on and so forth. So somehow, you know, in their brain, you know, there is what can be called the ballistic of the coordination of the body. You know, it's there, it's the law, and they can interpret that. So, translated into engineering terms, you know, what this means is that if I want to construct a system able to understand, you know, the interaction, then I need to design the system, I need to put in the system also the skills to act. I need to study, you know, this embodiment. The robot is going in the center there. It's not outside. I mean, even if my interest is only to understand somehow. You know. And so what we see when you see someone else doing an action is just the surface, the outside. You know, our brain is actually seeing everything else. You know, also the sensory and the sensory motor coordination part. And how this happens, you know, and it is, I mean, and this is true for machines also, you know, all machines that are interacting. This, I come back to this idea of a wind tunnel, you know. We are interested in studying this human-machine interaction using a humanoid. When we discover the principle, then we can think of transferring that to a machine which does not have a humanoid shape. But at least we need to test that on that system. So the basic is a mutual understanding implemented. So if you have to execute an action, you have to reach a goal, you need an action representation. If you have to understand, you have to anticipate the goal of the action. This is what anticipation or understanding means. And you also need an action representation. What mirror neuron says is that you basically, these two representations are the same. You know, that's the basis of our you know, imagination, as I was saying. So, in short, you know, when we interact with the others, we implicitly assume that the others are feeling our own sensations and emotions. So, when I kiss someone, if someone else kisses me, you know, I feel something, you know, pleasure for that. Then, I always, if I want to give pleasure to someone else, I kiss someone else. Of course, these are things that you have to learn, because if you don't learn them, you make mistakes, you know, and then. And this is something that, you know, it's a mother's nightmare, you know, somehow, in this sense. So what I think in the future we need to do, you know, our long-term goal, is basically to extend this idea of a perception-action loop by taking into consideration the goal. You know, and if you add the goal to an action, you know, it's something like an exploration. You are exploring the environment. And you have to add the experience to the perception. And if you add that, you end up with the prediction. So it's the loop is a exploration prediction. We always, when we we go around, we always predict, try to predict what is going to happen on the basis of the past experience. And what we do, we go there and discover is if the prediction is true or not. It's slightly different from what we have been doing so far. So this is the basically the motivation of what we are doing, and in our department, you know, the strategy is to use the ICAP, the humanoid, as the integration tool to put together results coming from robotics and somehow from neuroscience, you know. With the ICAP, you know, we are trying to reach that goal that I was referring before. Unfortunately, we are still not there. So if you expect me to say, you know, to explain how we have done that, we don't have the answer yet. It's a long term goal. You know, with the ICAP, we have, you know, the two different goals. So one are the technologies, and you know, I'm in the heavens of technology, so I don't need to spend too much time here. But also, what is important is the scientific path that we have. You know, we have groups working on children, studying sensing, control, cognition, vision, force, and you know, all these. You can read all the list there. And we have another group working on sensing, control, cognition from the robotics point of view. More or less the same issues, you know. Visual sensors, skin, tactile, and so on and so forth. But what pulls the things together, the two groups together, you know, are topics like multimodal sensory integration. You know, we don't know how we do it in humans, and we don't know how to implement this in robots. You know, haptic perception and physical interaction, again, you know, unknown things on human side and on the robotic side. Motor synergies, redundancy. We have been listening to very interesting, extremely interesting talks in these last few days. So the basis, you know, we're starting from two different directions, but the questions are the same. The important questions are basically the same. And the other thing I want to stress is that with the ICAP, we want to build a community. I mean, there is no way. I mean, we think that we are a very smart group. We are here in a building which is full of very smart people. And, you know, if you, all the people sitting here and their labs, everybody's. I think there is no single lab that can actually solve the problems I was referring to before. So we need to extend this community, and we are trying to do that. I mean, this ICAP, we have 20 of them around. I think is one of the most used. It's an open platform, by the way. You can copy it if you want, extracting. And is this working or not? Well, I think it is working. And what I'm showing here are just a few video clips of behaviors that have been implemented by groups outside Genova. You know, the crawling by Oak Hispert, Peter Ford, Domini on learning. Well, there are many others, and I think we need this. And just to show where we are now, we are more or less where, you know, most of us are. I mean, we are not too far. I mean, this is basically the ICAP tracking a classical red ball, and you know, with force and torque. With force sensors on the arm, so it you know, it is in this case, maybe I can show it. You can see it in the lower part. There is a representation of the skin which covers the ICAP for, you know, arm and torso, and you know, you can detect the point of contact and the direction of force by using the tactile sensing and the force sensor on the shoulder. So it is pretty much what other people is doing. This one here is work done at the EPFL. By Martin Premiak, where you basically teach a robot to do actions, and then you will see the robot itself doing the same actions. So it is not something on the upper part. You see well, basically with using the force feedback on the legs, balancing. So I will skip this, this final clip because there is not much time, because I want to spend the last 5 minutes on what's next. Okay? What's next? I'll try to condense this, but I think it is important. We are roboticians here. We have been working in neuroscience for many years. You know, what's next? What is important to put into the equation? What we miss? You know, I think that what we miss is the fact that, in terms of biological systems, the fact that our systems grow. You know, natural minds, our minds are shaped by interaction. But in nature, in biological systems, also the body is shaped by interaction. It's not fixed. It's not aluminium. It's not you know, titanium. It's something that changes through the interaction. It's a different degree of freedom that nature has. You know, and when you learn something in your brain, things changes in shape. The shape of your neuron change whenever you learn something. It's not you know. So is this a unique of biological system? You know, if you look at solutions in biology, you know, they are a collection of different solutions, you know, from muscle elasticity to mirror neurons, as I was saying. But we need to add another dimension there, and this is probably that's material science. We need to take this seriously into consideration, I think. And when I mean seriously, to drive the system, not wait for the community of material science people to give us something, but talk to them and ask them what you need, what you want. Try to reverse the things. And let me skip these two. And what I think, you know, is that if you want to go, you know, if I have to bet on the future, I think from now, you know, to, you know, in 10, 20 years, we have to invest in two topics: learning from the mind side and compliance from, but this is something that is useless to say here, where this idea of compliance was invented. So I thank you very much for your attention, and sorry if I went through. Okay. Thanks, take care.